Okay, let's keep going. So this is the lung, the outside is the pleural membrane, it's a double membrane structure. And there are fluid outside this layer. And this fluid is like you put liquid, one drop of water between two glasses. It's naturally glue those two glasses together. And that's how the lung glue to the pleural membrane. And outside the pleural membrane touch the ribs. So every time the ribs, every time you breathe, the ribs extend out, you will pull this out and you will pull the lung out as well. In physics, we talk about the Boyle's law, the pressure multiplied volume equal to constant for a closed chamber. And for breathing, we follow this law. When you breathe, you contract the diaphragm, you contract the intercostal muscle, that's the muscle between the ribs, which extend the thoracic cage. And when the thoracic cage been extended, the volume increase, the pressure decrease. And this pressure decrease creates a negative pressure, which makes the air flow from the outside into your lung. And when we calculate the partial pressure, we use the Dalton's law, which indicate the partial pressure of a specific gas molecule depends on the total pressure multiplied by the percentage of that gas molecule. So when we calculate the oxygen's partial pressure, we take 760 millimeter mercury and multiply about 21%, that's the percentage of oxygen, and you get about 160 millimeter mercury. If the air is humid, you actually have to take 760, subtract out the partial pressure of water and multiply by the percentage. So it turned out if the air is humid, it's actually decreased the partial pressure of the oxygen. Now let's look at the muscle for breathing. For breathing, you use these three muscles. Four muscles, I talk about three of them. The first one, the most important one, is the diaphragm. When you inhale, the diaphragm contract and move down, increases the thoracic cage. The second one called external intercostal muscle. This is the muscle you have between your ribs. You have them between your ribs. So when you go to the counting line, you eat ribs, and there's this muscle. And when you contract, you're gonna bring the ribs up and out. The third one, two muscles, sternocleidomastoid and scalens. I'll focus on the sternocleidomastoid. This is a big muscle. The name looks scary, but the name tells you where the muscle attach. So sternum, that's connected to the sternum. Cleido, clavicle. So that's where the muscle start. We call the origin. Attached to the sternum and clavicle. It go to the mastoid. You don't have a bone called mastoid, but you have an area called mastoid process of the temporal bone. So it's an area in your temporal bone. So this is the muscle you have in your neck. When you put your finger, touch your neck, you won't miss it. It's a huge muscle. This is the muscle support your head and also make you be able to move your head. And when this muscle contract, it will move the ribs out as well. So all these three muscles, when they contract, they move the thoracic cage volume increase. And when the volume increase, it creates a negative pressure, the pressure decrease. And this pressure makes the air flow in, flow out. If you only do the quiet breathing means you are not exercising. That's all the muscle you need, and the main one is the diaphragm. When you exhale, you just relax this muscle and the air can flow out because the volume decrease and the pressure increase, and that pressure is going to push the air out. If you start to exercise, you want to increase the volume difference, because the bigger volume difference, a bigger pressure difference, which will make more air flow in, flow out. You start to use this muscle, like the internal intercostal muscle. Muscle have layers, so the inside called internal intercostal, outside called external intercostal. And this one, abdominal muscle, rectus abdominis, if you took anatomy, and that's the muscle. That's your six packs. And six packs really have function. It's not just cosmetic function. Its function is breathing. So if you want to practice this muscle, you need to exercise a lot, because this part is when you start to exercise, you start to use them. When you do the quiet breathing, that's all the muscle you need, and especially the diaphragm. The mechanism of breathing is very similar to the syringe. You play with it when you were kids. So that's your air pipes, that's your thoracic cage, and this plunge represents your diaphragm. When you breathe in, you move your diaphragm down. And when you move your diaphragm down, the thoracic cage volume increase. The volume increase, the pressure decrease. And this negative pressure make the air flow in. Pressure gradient make the air flow in. When you exhale, it's like you push the plunge up. When you push it up, the volume decrease. When the volume decrease, the pressure increase, because PV equal to constant. And this pressure will push the air out. So air can flow in, flow out when you move the diaphragm. And that's how you breathe. The lung not help too much, not exactly. The lung is a bag, excuse me, but it's a good bag. It's not just plastic bag. The lung has, the bag has two characteristics. One called compliance, the second called elastance. Compliance, I use the plastic bag as analogy. Good compliance is like a plastic bag, so it's very easy to extend. When you put the plastic bag and you wave it in the air, and suddenly it expanded. It's very easy to expand. So we call this good compliance, big compliance. And the second one called elastance, I use the rubber band as an analogy. A high elastance means it's like a rubber band, easy to recoil. So either one of them, if you only have one of them, is not good enough, because if your lung is high compliance, means it's very easy to extend, it helps you when you inhale. If your lung only have high elastance, means it's like a rubber band, so when you exhale, it can quickly recoil your back to make the air flow out. But if you only have high elastance, it's very difficult to inhale, because it's difficult to expand the rubber band. So it's like the premature babies, they don't have enough surfactant, and which will make the lung with high elastance. So it turned out your lung need to be balanced, always balanced, just right. So they have elastance, also have compliance. So your lung tissue have compliance and elastance. Either too high, too low, they're not good. Like low compliance is restrictive lung disease, like fibrotic lung disease. And this happens when you have dirty air. Usually smoking may or may not create this. Smoking will create something else, high compliance. This is due to the dirty air in the say those people, they work in the minefield for their whole life. And those dirty air are going to turn the lung tissue into scar tissue. That's fibrotic lung disease. And eventually, it's very difficult to expand the lung, low compliance. And also, it's pretty thick. The scar tissue is pretty thick. It will make it difficult for the air to go from the lung into the blood. So these are the reasons cause the fibrotic lung disease. High compliance is not good either. like emphysema, usually due to smoking. Emphysema is due to smoking. And the smoking will damage the elastic fiber. So it's like you gradually lose those rubber band. And now the lung like is like a plastic bag. It's very easy to extend, but difficult to recoil. And difficult to recoil, it has no problem for inhale. It has problem for exhale. It's very difficult to breathe out, breathe CO2 out. So one common factor you found in smoker, is they have more CO2 in their body because they have difficulty to exhale to get those CO2 out, fresh air in. Okay, let's take a short break.